musicians to come, and let's stand tonight to worship the Lord. Start to call upon the Lord. Lord, we thank you here tonight. We praise you, Lord. We magnify you, Lord. We give you the glory and the honor. We exalt you, Lord God. You are worthy. Lord, you are worthy of all honor and glory, power and praise, Lord God. We thank you here, Lord, tonight for this opportunity. Lord, we thank you for those that are gathered. Lord, we seek you, Lord God, here tonight. Lord, be here in the midst of us to touch us, to lift us, to strengthen us, Lord God, to open the eyes of our understanding, Lord God. Lord, you are worthy. There's none like you, Lord God. Lord, you're our help. You're our strength, Lord God. Us with your power and your might, Lord God. There's none like you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Let's praise the Lord, everyone.
Hallelujah.
Amen. While we're waiting for Sister Amy, kind of an exciting thing that happened today for my friend Elizabeth, who you guys know came to church that one Sunday, the one from East Boston that came here from Germany years ago. She had an opportunity through her niece, I'm going to say, because I'm not sure of the connection, to be interviewed on the radio about her life a little bit and how the impact of some of the political things going on in our country is remind her very much of the Germany that she came from, where there was communism and socialism. And just praying that the Lord used her, you know, testimony of her life to impact some people, help them to think about, you know, how life needs to be in America. We thank God for the free America that we live in. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Let's worship him tonight.
Come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He's never failed us yet. Oh, we can't turn back. We've come this far by faith. We've come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He's never failed us yet.
praise God. You just have to rewrite that song and take out that word yet, because I'm not expecting them to fail.
All right.
And just need to plug a different word into there.
Hallelujah.
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 Praise God. Amen. You've got to move. To do this song and see. You guys ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you see it?
You've got to move. You've got to move. You've got to move. You've got to move. Oh, when the Lord gets ready, you've got to move. You've got to move. You've got to move. You've got to move.
Ready.
You've got to move, you've got to move, you've got to move. You may be high, you may be low, you may be rich, you may be poor. When the Lord gets ready, you've got to move, you've got to move, you've got to move. You've got to move, you've got to move, you've got to move, you've got to move. Oh, when the Lord
getting ready,
you've got to move,
you've got to move,
you've got to move.
The Lord
gets ready. You've got to move. You've got to move. Oh, you've got to move. You've got to move. You've got to move. You've got to move.
When the Lord
gets ready, you've got to move.
You've got to move.
You may be high, you may be low, you may be rich,
you may be poor,
but when the Lord gets ready, you've got to move.
You may be rich,
you may be low,
you may be rich,
and you may be poor,
but when the Lord
getting ready,
you've got to move. You may be poor,
but when the Lord gets ready,
you've got to move,
you've got to move.
Help us to move when you say move. Help us to stand, Lord God, when it's time to stand. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, God.
Oh, he's an on-time God. Yes, he is. He's an on-time God. Yes, he is. time to come. But it be there right on time. Oh, he's an on time God. Yes, he is. Oh, he's an on time God. Yes, he is. He's an on time God. Yes, yes, he is. He's an on-time God. Yes, he is. He's an on-time God. Yes, he is. Well, he may not be there when you want him to, but he'll be there right on time. Oh, he's an on-time God. Yes, he is. Oh, he's an on-time God. Yes, he is. He's an on-time God. Yes, he is. Well, he may not be there when you want him to, but he'll be there right on time. He's an on-time God. Yes, he is. On-time God, yes, he is. Oh, he's an on-time God, yes, he is. Well, he may not be there when you want him to, but he'll be there right on time. Oh, he's an on-time God, yes, he is. If you've tried everything and everything has failed, try Jesus. If you've tried everything and everything has failed, try Jesus. He'll be your dearest friend. Go with you to if you've tried everything and everything has failed, try Jesus. Oh, if you've tried everything and everything has failed, try Jesus. If you've tried everything and everything has failed, try Jesus. Tried everything and everything has failed, try Jesus. Oh, if you've searched everywhere and found nothing there, try Jesus. If you've searched everywhere
everything has failed, try Jesus.
If you've tried everything,
everything has failed, try Jesus. If you've searched everywhere and found nothing there, try Jesus.
If you've searched everywhere and found nothing there, try Jesus. He'll be your dearest friend. Go with you. And found nothing there, try Jesus. Oh, if you've tried everything and everything has failed, try Jesus. If you've tried everything and everything has failed, try Jesus. He'll be your dearest friend. Go with you to the end. If you've tried everything and everything has failed, try Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Demons will have to flee.
Tell me
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. In that mighty name.
Yes, amen.
Give that name a praise. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord God. Lord, we magnify you, Lord. We exalt you, Lord. We give you the glory and the honor. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, musicians here tonight. Amen. The mighty name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God, the mighty name. Oh, we praise you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. You can open your Bibles here tonight to 1 Kings 16:31. Amen. That'll be a starting point. And we're in spiritual warfare, but we're going to talk about the spirit of Jezebel tonight. The spirit of Jezebel. Amen. Praise God. 1 Kings 16:31. Very important. I think you'll understand that it's probably one of the main spirits that we're wrestling with in the world, in this country right now, is the spirit of Jezebel. Amen. So it says in 1 Kings 16:31. You can just move it to the next slide, too, because then we'll go to 21, 25, and then Revelation 2 and 20. So we're going to go across those three scriptures there. It says, and it came to pass as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, that he took to wife Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Zidonians, and went and served Baal and worshipped him. And if you read a little further, actually, we'll read a couple more verses there. And he reared up an altar for Baal in the house of Baal, which he had built in Samaria. And Ahab made a grove, and Ahab did more to provoke the Lord God of Israel to anger than all the kings of Israel that were before him. Amen. Then in 1 Kings 21 and 25. Amen. 1 Kings 21 and 25. But there was none like unto Ahab, which did sell himself to work wickedness in the sight of the Lord, whom Jezebel his wife stirred up. So Jezebel is the main force behind Ahab. Ahab is not a good guy, but he actually might have responded different if he'd had a godly wife. But in this case, it's clear that Jezebel's stirring him up to do some of the things that he's doing. And then Revelation 2 and 20. We're looking at the church of Thyatira. And it says, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. Okay, and the problem is not that she's a woman teaching, but the problem is she's teaching things that are seducing the people of God and leading them into areas that God has said not to be involved in. So let's talk about a little bit of background to understand this. Jezebel, the name means Baal exalts, or Baal is husband. Husband to, or to be unchaste. Okay, so, and all of those things definitely apply to Jezebel. So Jezebel was the daughter of Ethbaal, the king of Zidon or Sidon, which in this case actually refers to Tyre. So sometimes when they talk about Sidon in the Bible, it's referring to Tyre. Sometimes it's referring to the whole area that we would call Phoenicia, okay? And in this particular case, it's actually referring to Tyre. And if you search this out, you can find some scriptures. So now here's the background of Sidon. This is interesting. Sidon was founded by Canaan's son, Sidon. So now remember that Canaan was cursed, right? Canaan is the grandson of Noah that was cursed by Noah for what was going on. So, and they became, the Canaanites came through them. Okay, so Genesis 10, 15, 19, you can look that up. So Tyre was founded by the Sidonians. So Isaiah 23 and 12, if we'll look at that. Isaiah 23 and 12, and it says, and he said, thou shalt no more rejoice, O thou oppressed virgin daughter of Zidon. Arise, pass over to Chittim. There also thou shalt have no rest. And if you read back in the passage, you'll find out it's talking about Tyre. So Tyre is called the daughter of Sidon, or Zidon, which means that the Sidonians were the original founders of Tyre. Okay, so this is interesting. So Tyre and Sidon are cities of what we would call in history Phoenicia. And out of that city of Tyre also went the lady that founded Carthage of Roman Empire. Okay, so there's a lot of different things that are going on. Okay, a little more background. Ethbaal, Jezebel's father, he was priest of Astarte, and he became king by murdering the former king, Phales, the king of Zidonia. So Astarte, he was the priest of Astarte, but Astarte is another name for Ashtaroth or Asherah, which is really what the word groves is translated from. So sometimes you read about groves in the Old Testament, and it's talking about those. And really the word is Asherah, which is really referring to Ashtaroth, okay, and which is the female counterpart to Baal. Okay, Baal's the male side. Ashtaroth is the female side. So it was a male-female couple or consort, you know, and it was a licentious kind of a relationship. So the Asherah were related to the groves, which are company Baal worship. So when we think about grove in our mind, we think a bunch of trees or something. But it appears that it was actually wooden structures or hangings that represented the gods, or the gods that they were worshiping there. And they probably were like little, you know, compartments, you know, that would hold these gods, maybe hanging in the air. So Baal was the principal male god of the Phoenicians. Baal worship is also associated with Molech worship, Jeremiah 19 and 5. This is important to understand this, how it all ties together. Okay, and Jeremiah 19 and 5, we see that they have built also the high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings unto Baal, which I commanded not, nor spake it, neither came it into my mind. Okay, so now if you are familiar with Moloch, okay, Moloch was an idol that had its hands out like this, and they would come and heat the idol up red hot, and they would put their children in this idol and sacrifice it, okay? So we understand that Moloch and Baal, they're related. The only difference is kind of a cultural twist on it, okay? And so Moloch involved the offering of children, and this is really where the Valley of Hinnom kind of sprung up here, because they were doing it down there. Baal worship involved sexual immorality. Okay, we know this from the book of Numbers with Balaam and Baal Peor. Okay, and so when we look at that in Numbers 25, 1 and 2, we're trying to give a full picture here so you understand what's going on. Okay, Numbers 25, 1 and 2. And he says, and Israel abode in Shittim, and the people began to commit whoredom with the daughters of Moab. And they called the people unto the sacrifice of their gods, and did eat, and the people did eat, bowed down to their gods. And Israel joined unto Baal Peor, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel. So Baal was the first time that Israel got involved with this, was right before they went into the promised land. Okay, right after Balaam had blessed Israel, he couldn't curse them. But he went over to the Midians, apparently, and he let them know, understand that if you'll invite the children of Israel to your sacrifices, they will bring judgment upon themselves, because they will condemn themselves by violating the law of the Lord. Okay, now there's a very important lesson there. That's how the enemy works today. Sometimes to try to invite us into an area where we get into a place that we're not right with God, and we allow things to happen in our lives. So that's why we have to be careful. Not paranoid, but careful. All right? Right? We have to have the Spirit of God discernment, know the Word of God, and you have to have it settled in your mind, okay? Now, so Baal Peor was one of those. Baal is also related to Bel of Babylon, Isaiah 46, 1 and Jeremiah 52 and 51. But if you look the word up, Bel is a contracted form of Baal. So they're all the same. So Bel is Babylon. Okay, and Assyria comes out of Babylon, the Bible tells us. Okay, and then the Canaanites, you know, they're related. Okay, and so all these related religions, they have this Baal worship. It's a fertility, sexual kind of orgy worship, and a, you know, wind nature kind of a god. So through Jezebel, who was the daughter of Ethbaal from Tyre, when she married Ahab, it introduced this worship into Israel and created a lot of problems for Israel. So what Jezebel did is she made Baal worship the state religion. So now again, if you ever need a lesson about who you ought to marry, okay, here's a clear lesson that if you marry somebody that's outside of the faith, they can bring things into your life that will create a problem for you. All right? This is why the Bible says not to be unequally yoked. And yet many people that are Christians or call themselves Christians will violate this principle because they think, oh, I'm so in love, you know, and God wouldn't make me love, you know, somebody or let me love somebody this strongly, you know, if it wasn't the right thing. That's not true. Okay? Because sin can be strong enough or desire can be strong enough, and the devil uses normal desires to draw us away from the things of God. Amen. So we need to understand that it's very important that we do things God's way, especially marriage. I mean, marriage is the highest, strongest relationship within family. You got to get them saved first. That's usually the big trap of the enemy. You know, I'll marry them and bring them to faith. Most of the time, they get sucked out of church or they end up divorced. That's the history of it, okay? 99%. It's not impossible, but the majority of the times when a person says, yeah, I'm going to win them to the faith, you know, and I'm going to bring them in, usually they end up being drawn out because you're unequally yoked. The picture is two animals pulling a plow together that are not the same kind. So an ox and a cow or an ox and a donkey, the ox is going to drag the other animal because it's stronger in its nature. Amen. One's going to win, the other one's not. But if they're the same type of animal, then they have the same nature to pull. Amen. They pull at the same rate. Okay, now one of the important things about the spirit of Jezebel, it's a high ranking spirit. There's a lot of spirits under Jezebel. And we'll bring this out, okay? Does it say that like this in the Bible? But no, when we look at the characteristics of her and we start to see the offshoots, we find out that there are a lot of spirits that are underneath Jezebel, which is what makes her so strong. So the first thing, the main characteristics of Jezebel, it's a spirit of control. Jezebel is a spirit of control. And it uses three primary areas to achieve this control. Okay, it uses intimidation. It uses seduction / deception. And it uses usurping authority. Okay, so in other words, the example of usurping authority we'll look at later on, but she writes letters in Ahab's place. Even though she's the queen, she doesn't really have authority to do that. Amen? Okay, so it's important to understand. Intimidation. So the spirit of Jezebel will come at you. This is why I say it's one of the spirits we're dealing with now. When somebody stands up to say something right, look at all the media that comes and tries to intimidate a person to knock them down. Okay, they don't bring a fact. They don't present a rational case. They don't say, why do you think that? They just slam at you to make you feel like you're wrong. There's something wrong with you. You're prejudiced. You're bigoted. You're racist. You're something, you know, you're a chauvinist. You're something. They just lay a label on you. That's intimidation. That is intimidation. So we can see that that spirit is working very strongly in the world today, particularly in this country. Okay, so let's look at some of these scriptures here. 1 Kings 19, 1 and 2. And we know, I think we all know the story of Elijah pretty clearly. But let's analyze maybe a couple of the passages in there and extract some information from there. So 1 Kings 19, 1 and 2. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and with how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, so let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow, this time. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life, and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. So even though Elijah has done what God has asked him to do, he didn't make it up. God sent him the word about this, tell Ahab, there's going to be rain. So Elijah goes and does it. So Elijah is doing what God asked him to do. But even though he's done what God has asked him to do and God has given him a great victory, she intimidates him. So he runs. That's the spirit of Jezebel. That's one of the first ways that she tries to work a lot of times, is with intimidation. And again, when you witness to people, you may have experienced that witnessing to people. You sometimes try to say something, and they might say something like, how dare you, you know, talk to me about Jesus? You know, one time we went through a toll booth on the way up to New Hampshire, and I said, God bless you. And you could hear the guy screaming 100 yards away. So don't you ever say that again, as we drove away. You know, I mean, literally, I mean, he was screaming. Okay, he was so mad. But what he was trying to do is intimidate me from ever saying that again to anybody. That's how the enemy works. Okay, and well, we got to be prayed up, brother. Okay, we do things by the Spirit of God and the strength of God. Amen. Amen. So 2 Kings 9 and 31, again. 2 Kings 9 and 31, and Jehu entered at the gate, and she said, had Zimri peace who slew his master? So Jehu's come, and he's already killed Joram, the king of Israel, who is Jezebel's son. And she tries to seduce him. When that doesn't work, she tries to intimidate him. So Zimri was a person before Omri. So when Jeroboam didn't do what God wanted him to do, and they had the golden calf, God gave four generations to Jeroboam. And then there was a couple kings that came in, and one of those was Zimri. So now she tries to say, you think you're going to get away with this? Zimri didn't get away. She's trying to intimidate him, even though Jehu has been anointed by God to do what he's doing. You with me? Look, it's important, okay? So just because you got an anointing and calling of God doesn't mean the enemy backs off, especially the spirit of Jezebel will try to intimidate you to get you to back down from what God has called you to do. All right? Praise God. All right, seduction and deception. We'll back up a verse there. And when Jehu was come to Jezreel, Jezebel heard of it, and she painted her face and tired her head, looked out the window. In other words, she put on all her mascara and tried to make herself look with sexual appeal and tried to make herself look good. So her first thrust was, let me see if I can seduce him. When that doesn't work, intimidation. All right? So a lot of times the spirit of Jezebel will try to seduce you, try to get you to come her way by appealing to us. All right, so we're seduction and deception. All right, usurping authority, 1 Kings 21, 5 through 8. 1 Kings 21:5, this is when Naboth would not sell his vineyard or exchange it to Ahab. Ahab became very depressed and disappointed. But Jezebel, his wife, came to him and said unto him, "Why is thy spirit so sad that thou eatest no bread?" And he said unto her, "Because I spake to Naboth the Jezreelite and said unto him, Give me the vineyard for money, or else if it please thee, I will give thee another vineyard for it. And he answered, I will not give thee my vineyard. And Jezebel, his wife, said unto him, Dost thou not govern the kingdom of Israel? Arise and eat bread and let thine heart be merry. I will give thee the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite. So she wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed it with his seal and sent the letters unto the elders and to the nobles that were in his city dwelling at Naboth. And she wrote in the letters saying, Proclaim a fast and set Naboth on high among the people and set two men, sons of Belial, before him to bear witness against him saying, Thou didst blaspheme God and the king and then carry him out and stone him that he may die. So even though it's true that Ahab didn't say, no, I don't want you to write letters, you don't have authority, she knew she didn't have authority. She's not the king. But she's taking that authority of her own will. Okay, so sometimes that's the spirit of Jezebel. It's usurping authority. It's taking up authority to do something. And sometimes it's done under the guise of, well, it turned out good. Or it was a good thing. Or it was a needed thing. Okay, we've got to understand that unless God gives us authority, just because it turns out good doesn't validate a person usurping the authority. Amen? Very important. Okay, and sometimes that happens even in the church with people that are Holy Ghost filled. They step over boundaries. Okay, I was reading a story by a man that I respect a lot, that is called a prophet. He's got some books on spiritual warfare. He's an apostolic. He's in the UPC. And he was talking about how there was a family, there was a young man and his wife that were married, and they almost had their marriage broken up because every day she would cook him something, and on the way home, when he came from work, he would go by his mother's house, and his mother would always have a meal cooked up for him and invite him to stay, and he wouldn't get home to his wife's meal. And he said in the book, he said it was the spirit of Jezebel, even though the mother did not know she was doing that, because she was not letting her authority go from that to allow him to be the husband of that new wife. You understand what I'm saying? And once they understood and addressed the problem, everything cleared up. Okay, and so sometimes, even in the church, that things like that can happen that are not of God. Okay? So at Thyatira, well, we're not going to talk a lot about this, but just to reference the New Testament reference, at Thyatira, the reference to Jezebel is to a false prophetess. It's not the fact that she's a woman or a prophet, but it's the fact she's a false prophetess. That's the issue. And she's using seduction. She's seducing the saints of God to induce believers into going to idolatrous feasts, which included immorality. This is what was going on there. This is the basic thing. And there may have been more things beyond that, but that's the basic idea. Now, whether Jezebel was her real name, don't know, okay? But she's definitely a type of Jezebel in the fact that she was using seduction, using prophecy, false prophecy. See, false prophecy is seduction. Okay, and again, that's the spirit of the end age, right? Let no man deceive you by any means, for many false prophets in Christ shall arise. Right? That's so deception and seduction. People are seduced by false prophecies. There are people that are seduced by you know, this, you know, have your own life, live your best life here. Okay, you know, get everything the way you want it. Name it and claim it. You know, you don't hear it that way anymore, but the same idea is propagated. Okay, and so they're, you know, given this, you know, idea, this gospel where everything is good. Well, God does meet us and God is good to us, but it doesn't mean that there's no low places or hard places in there. Amen. And so false prophecy can seduce people. It can seduce people into believing something that's not right. And so that's the New Testament revelation. So now, what our book of Revelation, what that's talking about. So now let's delve into this a little bit more. We said that there, Jezebel is a spirit of control, seeks to control through three main areas: intimidation, seduction / deception, and usurping of power. Okay, when we look at intimidation, we find out fear and discouragement come underneath that, right? That's why I say she's a large spirit, because the spirit of fear comes underneath that. Let's go back to 1 Kings 19 and let's read it again, and let's look at and see what happens to Elijah. 1 Kings 19:2. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, "So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them for tomorrow about this time." And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life, came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. So she intimidates, fear comes in, right? He yields to it, so fear comes in, the spirit of fear is working now. So he runs. Next thing we see, verse 4, but he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die, and said, "It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I'm not better than my fathers." Now he's discouraged. So underneath intimidation comes fear and discouragement. So what I'm trying to help you understand is when Jezebel works and she intimidates, there's usually other spirits of fear and intimidation that are work, fear and discouragement that are working there along with that. Amen? Seduction, deception. We saw that when we read in 2 Kings. The first thing she does is paint herself up, make herself nice, look out the window. And when Jehu doesn't buy it, the next thing was, had Zimri any rest after he killed his master? So she throws seduction. When that doesn't work, she throws intimidation. Okay, and so it's almost like a 1-2 punch. So I'm going to say that intimidation and seduction, oftentimes they're working together too. Okay, and deception. Fantasy. Okay, seduction and deception, they work with fantasy. Okay, the pleasures of sin. Okay, the reason people yield to sin is because they get focused on the pleasure they might get from it. Because if they took long enough to think about it, they say, "No, we're not going to do that." So Hebrews 11:25. Hebrews 11:25, talking about Moses, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Sin does have pleasure. That's why people commit it. That's why it attracts, because there is a season of pleasure. So people can be deceived by that. The fantasy of, if I just do this, if I just have this once, or, you know, God loves me enough, he's not going to withhold this good thing from me. You know, I've got a special situation. I know for everybody else, it's not right, it's wrong. But for me, because of my background and who I am and the pressures that are on me, it's okay for me to do that. Listen, that's how the spirits talk to us. That's what happens. And we make a reason for ourselves why sin is going to be okay. All right? And again, James 1:14. 1:14-15. So James chapter 1 verse 14, and every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust or desire and enticed. Then when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin when it is finished bringeth forth death. If you play on that desire long enough, it'll become that fantasy that this is going to take care of it. Just one more time, just this one time, you know, if I just do this. I mean, that's what happened to Eve, right? Isn't that what happened to Eve? She looked at that long enough and let the devil talk to her about it till she forgot all about what God thought and just started to think about what she wanted. Amen. So Eve was deceived, Genesis 3 and 6. And this is interesting when you look at it. Okay, Genesis 3 and 6, and maybe you've seen this. I had not seen this before, but somebody pointed it out to me recently. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. It doesn't say she's looking at the fruit. She's looking at the tree, the whole tree. Doesn't say she looked at when she saw the fruit was good to eat. She said when she saw the tree was good for food. And when she saw that it was a tree to be desired. So she's gone beyond just looking at the fruit. She's bought into the whole thing. She's got this fantasy. If I can just have this tree with me all the time, I'm going to be okay. Not understanding what's going to happen. And again, 1 Timothy 2:14 says that Eve was deceived and not Adam. Doesn't mean Adam didn't sin. Adam sinned by eating it because he knew he was not supposed to eat it. But Adam knowingly did it. Eve was deceived. So that's my point where seduction and deception work together, because she was seduced into thinking that this was better than what God said. And then she was deceived and she did it. All right, so deception and seduction, they work together. False prophets, again, false prophecies seduce people to get off track from God. Now, the Bible's not against prophecy, because the Bible says, despise not prophecy, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good, right? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, let's look at that. Okay, so we understand that. God's not against prophecy, even in the New Testament. Prophecy was a regular part of the church. Otherwise, Paul wouldn't even say these things here. Okay, but so in 1 Thessalonians 5:19, quench not the spirit, despise not prophesyings, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good, abstain from all appearance of evil. Okay, the fact that Paul is saying that lets us understand that gifts of the Spirit must have been normally working within the church. Otherwise, there's no reason to give instructions to quench not the Spirit and despise prophecies. Okay, but he says, and the reason he says despise not, that means that there's some false ones coming. Just because they're false, don't throw them all away. Just because there's some wrong ones, but test them, prove them, like John says, 1 John, right? Try the spirits, whether they be of God. Amen. So we've got to have discernment that's going on. We've got to have this understanding. False prophets. There's going to be false prophets. And some of them might hear from God, like Balaam. That's what makes it tough. All right? But if they're leading you, if it's not leading you closer to Jesus, is not causing you to love God more, is not causing you to want to be a witness, is not causing you to want to worship and give your life for God, then you need to be concerned about the prophecies where they're leading you. Amen? We really do. Okay, we need to do that. Okay, another thing that worked there, Under seduction and deception, is whoredom, sexual immorality, spiritual and physical, okay? Immorality, physical is sexual immorality. Spiritually, it's idolatry. Okay, and again, that was what was going on in Revelation, 2 and 20 at Thyatira. It's, part of that is idolatry. She's getting them into situations where they're starting to worship other gods. Okay, now the thing about gods, what we got to understand is, if we're given a situation and we've got two things to choose, and one thing is what God wants us to do and the other thing is something else, and that something else, even if it's not a sin, prevents us from doing what God wants us to do, we have bowed to the other thing. We made that an idol. We made that an idol. Amen? Let's just worship here a moment. Lord God, we thank you. We praise you. We love you, Lord God. Lord, we need your understanding. We need your peace upon our hearts and our minds. Lord God, to give us understanding, to see it your way, Lord God, to understand what we're dealing with. Lord, so we can have sober minds and understand and navigate the paths that you've ordained for us and the victory that you've ordained for us, Lord God. We give you glory. We give you praise. We thank you for the peace that passes understanding, Lord God. Hallelujah. We thank you for that. Amen. Amen. We thank you for that. 2 Kings 9:22, because I want to show you that why we brought the whoredoms in there. The Bible says it. Okay, so we're just not we're not just picking out something and saying, this seems like this is her character, so this is what it is. But in 2 Kings 9 and 22, when Jehu comes to execute what God has asked him to execute, I said 2 Kings. Yeah, I'm stuck in first. 2 Kings 9 and 22. Now I'm in 8. I'm getting there. 9 and 22. And it came to pass when Joram saw Jehu that he said, "Is it peace, Jehu?" And he answered, "What peace, so long as the whoredoms of your mother, Jezebel, and her witchcrafts are so many?" So again, right now we see whoredoms, okay, and we see witchcraft assigned to Jezebel. Okay, and of course, the worship of Baal involved sexual licentious rites and practices, just like Baal Peor. Okay, and so people that were getting involved in that. I heard one man recently refer to abortion as sacrifice to Baal. Okay, in other words, what's the God? They bowed to the God of sexuality over life. Woman's choice is to have sex when we want it, the way we want it, is more important than the life of the baby. You're offering up those babies to Baal, the God of licentious worship. Now, of course, the people that are doing that, they have no idea, but that's really what's going on in the spirit. Amen. It's kind of sobering, isn't it? Okay, we looked at intimidation, false prophets, whoredom, sexual immorality, the spirit of Jezebel, usurping authority. Okay, so when we read that passage there where she takes the authority to write a letter and to sign it in Ahab's name and so forth, the spirit of Jezebel is an instigator of evil. Not only was she usurping authority, she's using it for an evil deed. She's instigating evil in a town. And so she's writing a letter. And there's an element of intimidation there. It might be that a lot of people didn't know Ahab didn't write it because he signed it in her name, his name. But she wrote it. So she's usurping authority and she's instigating an evil action. Also lying in a slandering spirit. Again, we see that, don't we, in the media. The lying and slandering spirit. She's a lying, slandering spirit. Proclaim a fast, put Naboth on high, get two men of Belial and say that he blasphemed God and the king, which is a lie. Slandering the character of him and instigating evil, using an usurping of a power in order to obtain her end. That's the spirit of Jezebel. And we call it spirit of Jezebel. It doesn't mean it's necessarily a feminine spirit. It's a spirit. Okay, but it's a spirit that wants to control and uses intimidation, seduction, and usurping of power to maintain, to get control, and to maintain control. She's a promoter of false religion. Okay, that's easy. That one's pretty easy to see, right? Because she promotes Baal, and she, you know, promotes this worship, okay? And she makes it, this is the thing. So she's got 450 prophets, you know, at her table, or 400 prophets for the Asherah, and 450 other prophets to Baal are there. She's supporting all them. She's not supporting Jehovah's prophets. She's killing them. She's cutting them off. So Jezebel is a spirit that supports false religion. You see what I'm saying? She's a major ranking spirit, because underneath her there's fear, discouragement, you know, there's intimidation, there's whoredom, there's instigation of evil, there's promoting a false religion, there's persecuting of good. We saw that she has witchcraft. The word witchcraft in this particular case means sorcery. It's usually translated sorcery within in the Old Testament there. So she's involved in sorcery. Okay, so fascination with evil. You ever see a lot of kids that are fascinated with evil today? A lot of the video games and the movies, they glorify the evil and kind of draw you in. There's a fascination with evil. That's the edge of witchcraft working there to get kids involved in that. She's a persecutor of true religion. She cuts off the prophets and she kills them. She doesn't just support the religion she wants. She starts knocking out the other one that could be a threat. True religion. She's got a murderous spirit. She's killing them. She's not just saying you can't do that anymore. She's killing them. So the spirit of Jezebel is a murderous spirit. Amen. All right, so now we've kind of characterized it, and again, we'll just restate it, okay? It's a spirit of control that obtains control or maintains control using primarily intimidation, seduction, or usurping of power. All one or all three of those, and underneath those, there's other elements that we've talked about. They come under this, okay? So how do we deal with this? How do we deal with the spirit of control which uses intimidation, seduction, usurping authority to obtain or maintain control? First of all, we've got to have faith and trust in the Lord to order and deal with the spirit, okay? Faith in your relationship with God. Faith in what God has called you to do, not how you want it to turn out with. I think Elijah had faith in his relationship with God, but I think he thought the result was going to be different. And that's why he was discouraged. So sometimes God tells us to do things, but we in our mind come up with what we think the result is going to be. And when it doesn't turn out, we become discouraged. And we think, and the devil will come, or our own mind, and we'll think we miss God when really we did the will of God. It's important to understand that, okay? So faith and trust in your relationship with the Lord. That's why prayer is important, okay? Faith in your relationship with the Lord. Faith in the Lord's care for us. That God cares for us. It's essential for us to remember the Lord cares for us. So let's look at some scriptures that I've used a lot lately, but I think that they're important. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. In 1 Thessalonians 5:23, it says, "And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly." So the first thing is, he's the God of peace. It's not the God of judgment, and not the God of righteousness, not the God of, you know, power or something, but the God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless on the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that calleth you, who will also do it. So God is interested in all of us, not just our souls. God does care if we suffer here. Now, sometimes we do have to suffer because it's part of what we've got to go through for His glory or for our growing or both. But God cares. As that song used to go, God weeps along with man, takes him by the hand. Tears are a language God understands. Amen? God understands it. God sees us when we're in that. We got a high priest that knows. So he cares for us. Hebrews 13 and 5. Hebrews 13 and 5. Let your conversation, manner of life, be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For he said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. He cares. He cares. Okay. And it doesn't mean you shouldn't, that there's anything wrong with desiring something better or desiring more, but don't let that be a dominating factor. Don't let that be a driving ideal. How we handle disappointment says a lot about where we are with God. How we handle disappointment. Okay, amen. And so we don't want that to be a driving thing. Okay, 1 Peter 5 and 7. Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. So, you know, the main focus with these scriptures is God cares. The Lord cares about us. We may have to go through dry places. We may have to go through dangerous places. Though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, we may have to go through places that are tough. But God cares. The Lord cares. He does care when we suffer. He does care when we're going through things. Amen. Trust in the Lord, as we know the scripture, the proverb, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord. Depart from evil. Should be health to thy navel and marrow to thy bones. Sometimes sickness is the result of not trusting in God. When we trust in God, it says it's going to bring health to us. Health of your navel and your bones. Your bones is what produces the marrow that produces healthy blood that fights disease. Amen? Praise God. Amen. So, trusting in Lord. Our relationship with the Lord is the first place. Because, again, she's going to come with intimidation. You did this, you did that, you're not this, you're not that. Yeah, that's all true, but it's under the blood. And God asked me to do this. And what you're doing is wrong. So you can back off Jezebel. Amen. Amen. Okay, our relationship with God. Amen. That's key. Okay? If we're insecure with our relationship in the Lord, or we're insecure in our own life, we may come under the influence of the spirit of Jezebel. When fear has a foothold and a person may use unwittingly. Even people with the Holy Ghost may use intimidation because they're afraid if it goes this way, what's going to happen? So they may intimidate to try to get people to do a different choice or a choice that they feel comfortable with. That doesn't mean discussion is wrong. And it doesn't mean that that person is possessed by the spirit of Jezebel, but they're letting that influence work in them. If fear is driving them to use intimidation to turn a situation. Amen? Okay, or seduction or to usurp authority. Sometimes, again, people out of fear will step out of their range of authority to do something. Okay, and when they don't have authority to do that. Okay, so seduction and intimidation, as we mentioned that, they often work together. We saw that in 2 Kings 9, 30 and 31. Dealing with intimidation, the fear of discouragement. Okay, again, intimidation will come with fear and discouragement and try to get us out of the picture. So how do we deal with that? Of course, we know the scripture that God has not given us the spirit of fear, but power, love, sound mind. Even though we know that, that's a very important scripture. Even though we know that it's a scripture, we have to pray a lot. When you find yourself being down, fearful, or you find yourself being like you're being pushed back, that's a scripture that you need to believe in, that's the fear is not coming from God. Unless you're disobeying him knowingly. But if you're trying to live for God, then that fear is not coming from the Lord. It's coming from a spirit. And God has not given us that spirit of fear, okay? Okay, be in right standing with the Lord. So sometimes we're vulnerable to the enemy because we're not right standing with God. James 4, 6, but he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. So there's a measure of grace that comes when we submit to God that does not come when we're unsubmitted. All right, this is what this is saying. Submit yourself therefore to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. So when you're submitted to God, you have the authority and power to resist the devil. When you're not, then the devil can have a handhold on you. He can have an edge on you. All right? So we want to, he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Pride there can just mean that we want to do it our way rather than God's way. Even though our way may not be a sin. Just the fact that God says do it this way, but I'm going to do it this way. We are children, okay? When you're fighting the spirit of Jezebel or any spirit, again, you need to know you're a child of God. Okay, 1 John. Okay, well, back to Baal there, James 4, 16. Baal means Lord or master. So you got to be submitted to the right Lord. Okay? You got to make sure you're submitted to Jesus. Okay? Know that the Lord loves you, 1 John 4, 18. Perfect love. Cast out fear, because fear hath torment. Amen. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. I might have moved the verses around, the words around a little bit, but the ideas are there. Okay? And so the fact is our relationship with God, knowing that God loves us and that we love the Lord, gives us authority over fear. It casts it out. I don't have to be afraid. I don't have to be afraid of what the enemy says, because I know that's not true. I know that God loves me and I love him. So those arguments, they fall to the ground. They fall to the side. We're his children. Romans 8, 15. Look over there. Romans 8, 15 says, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage, again, to fear. See, that's what sin does and the devil does. It puts us in a spirit of bondage where we're afraid. We're afraid to break out. We're afraid to resist the devil. You have not received the spirit of bondage, again, to fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The spirit within us, God's spirit within us, causes us to want to connect with the Lord. 1 John 3, 1 through 2, 1 and 2 says, beloved, now are we the sons of God. Now, not tomorrow. I don't have to wait till I'm raptured to be a son of God. I'm a son of God now. Now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when we see him, we shall be like him. Amen. So, in other words, we've got faith that Because we are the Son of God, if we continue to live for God, the Lord will change us. He'll make up the difference, what's lacking in us when the time comes. When the translation comes, he'll supply all the things that are needed. Let's read that again. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. That's why when you're living for God, the world doesn't understand you. You see that movie? No, I didn't see it. Everybody's watching it. I don't care. How can you can? Did you watch that? No. Did you go here? No. You better invest in this. No, I don't need to. Now, I'm not saying investments are wrong. I'm not saying that, okay? What I'm saying is you can pray, make your investment, leave with God. God can crash the whole stock market and leave your stocks good. He's God. He can have your stocks invested in a place where everybody else crashes and yours went up. He's God. He's the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. The Lord is in control. Romans 8:28. Again, a great scripture. We know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, to them who are the called according to his purpose. And of course, the purpose is that we become conformed to the image of the Son, right? Verse 29. So God is working all those things together. Amen. And I hear different interpretations, but my understanding that is like in Genesis 50 and 20, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. So what Joseph went through initially was indeed evil and wrong. But God had a way of taking that evil and making it, fitting it into his picture to work good. So we can have bad things happen to us in the past or in our life. And if we'll just trust God and give it to God, in the end, God brings that in and makes it work for good in the overall picture of our life. Amen. Praise God. Maintain your relationship with the Lord, praying in the Holy Ghost, the book of Jude, verses 20 and 21. But ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourself in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. So by praying in the Holy Ghost, that helps build your holy faith up, and it keeps you in the love of God. That's why it's important to pray in tongues. It's important to get into the level when you're praying that you enter into the dimension where you're praying in tongues, at least part of the time, where tongues can flow. Where if God wants you to speak in tongues, you can speak. And if he doesn't want you, that's fine. But you're in that place where, whichever way the Spirit's going, you can yield to that. That's what builds up our holy faith. And that keeps us in the love of God. Why? Because when we enter in that dimension, in his presence is fullness of joy, at his right hand are pleasures forevermore. We enter into the presence of God, the peace of God that defies understanding, starts to work on us, and it helps us see what God is doing. It reinforces what God has taught us, the truth of what God has given us, the holy faith, and it reinforces our relationship with God because we feel his presence. We know he loves us and we love him. Amen. Praise God. So again, maintaining your relationship with the Lord. Notice that Elijah recovered from fear and discouragement by getting into the presence of the Lord. Right? That's what he did. He did run, but he didn't just run off the map. Amen. He felt like giving up, but he didn't give up. But he went back to the place, and some people even believe he went to the very cleft in the rock where God put his hand over Moses. There's some that believe that, whether that's true or not. He did go to the mountain where God had talked to Moses. And so he went there, and God talks to him. And by the time Elijah leaves, he's ready. And I've heard people say, well, Elijah lost his ministry there. He never recovered. That's not what the Bible says. That's not at all what the Bible says. I've heard that preached. But notice, Elijah comes back and he anoints Elisha. God is not going to have somebody whose ministry has failed and wiped up be the mentor to the next guy. And Elijah then confronts Ahab at Naboth's vineyard after this. And Elijah sits on a hill and says, if I be a man of God, let fire come down and burn up the company of 50. He's not a guy that his ministry's gone. His ministry's working. And he knows when God's going to call him. And when he comes to the Jordan River, he doesn't say, wait for a ferry. Bam, with his mantle, and he walks over on dry ground. Amen. So even though we can have obstacles, if we'll get to the presence of God, God can help us and keep us on track. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Again, be transformed. Okay, dealing with the spirit of seduction and deception. How do we deal with that? Transformed by the renewing of our mind. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, present your bodies a living sacrifice, which is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. When your mind gets renewed, you see what's the real truth. You see what really matters and what doesn't matter. You see how God sees things. And when your mind is really seeing that, you can't be seduced. You can't be deceived, okay? You can't be seduced because you realize that might be attractive, but it's only going to last for a little bit. The pleasures of sin for a season. I know that sin leads to death. I know the darkness that goes with sin. When you're in your right mind with God, you know the things that sin is going to lead to. And seduction's not going to work because you know where it goes. Again, you know, the Bible says, be sure your sin will find you out. In other words, you might do it in secret, but your sin will catch up with you if you continue to live in it. Amen. Pleasure sin only lasts for a season. So seek the Lord and the kingdom of God. Seek the Lord and his kingdom. Colossians 3:1-2 says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Amen. Blessed is the person who endures temptation. God allows temptation, but there's a blessing in it. There's a crown that comes. And we've got to crucify the flesh. Sometimes we've got to do that. We've got to remember that in living for God, there's things that our flesh may want that have to be crucified because God says, they're not legal. Amen? So the spirit of Jezebel, it's a high-ranking spirit with a lot of other spirits, witchcraft and whoredoms. If we see all that, we see that around us. That's underneath Jezebel. Tattoo parlors and all this stuff. Okay, that's getting people to put marks on their body. It's not of God, or even if it is God. God does tells us not to mark our bodies, right? Praise God. If a person's got a tattoo before they came to the Lord, it's under the blood, just don't get any more. Amen. Just don't get any more. Amen. Let God have his way. Spirit of Jezebel, spirit of control, uses intimidation, seduction / deception, and in usurping of power to get control or maintain it. But we can resist that by having our relationship with God secure. Amen? Now we got to get scriptures in us because when things happen and these things hit you, a lot of times you got to bring a scripture up. You got to bring something up. And when you bring the right thing up, everything settles out. Amen? Let's stand tonight. Definitely, we're dealing with the spirit of Jezebel in this country. Amen. I'm not saying that's the only spirit that there is, but it's definitely one of the main spirits that's working right now. Lord God, we thank you here tonight. Lord, we understand for us as humans, Lord, this is heavy, weighty. Lord God, can be intimidating to us, just the idea of it. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, spirits, and high places. But Lord, you've given us power over all the power of the enemy, you said. You didn't say you gave us power over part of the enemy, but all the power of the enemy. You said, nothing shall any means hurt you. Lord, you said, greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. Lord, you said you'd not leave us comfortless, but you'd come to us. Lord, we thank you tonight, Lord God, that we can have the victory through you. Lord, as your word says, that we're more than conquerors through you that loved us, Lord God. Hallelujah. We are able to overcome, that neither height nor depth, angels, principalities, powers, things present, things to come, are greater, that can separate. None of that can separate us from your love, Lord God. We give you the glory and the honor, and we praise you. And Lord God, we know that you called us for such a time as this. Lord, we know that you're going to have a church. You're coming for a church without spot or wrinkle. Lord, you put us in the church. You're going to give us the ability to be the church if we seek you, Lord God. We give you the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, everyone said amen. Amen. You're dismissed in the name of the Lord. God bless you.